That kind of leads us into the thesis for this book. And I think a big part of this work that you've done is kind of a response to this college for all mentality or college for all movement, that this is just going to create endless opportunities for everybody, whether they're fit for college or not. But the thesis that you
What do
put
you
forth,
mean? Everyone's fit for college.
exactly. I mean, that kind of egalitarian idea, and we see the problems that that's causing, the social problems that it's causing on a lot of campuses across the country. And it has been for years, where people, in this whole like social justice movement, people feel really out of place. I've talked a lot with Professor Thaddeus Russell about this. I'm sure you're somewhat familiar with his work. And he was on the Occidental campus when a lot of action unfolded there. And he's been saying, this is part of this idea that everybody needs to be fed into college as some kind of equality or social justice project, and it's having really, really negative results, ironically, but isn't this always the case for the people that it is most designed, kind of ham-fistedly designed to help? So, the thesis that you're putting forward is that right now, civilized, technologically advanced, first world societies revolve around the education system. And you're suggesting that there is a better way to do this. Right now, what's happening is this idea that everyone gets a college degree and there'd be great jobs. That's not true. What we have instead is a kind of runaway credential inflation. And you write, trying to spread success with education spreads education, but not success. So what is this idea of credential inflation?
So it's the idea that if you just go and compare the amount of education that you need to get a job, not do a job, but get a job, it's risen tremendously over the last 70 years. So I mean, roughly by a full degree. So in the book, I talk a lot about sociologists, especially who have gone and just compared how much education would a waiter at a fancy restaurant have today versus a long time ago, or like, the concierge at a nice hotel, or they'll just go down a bunch of very mundane jobs. And you'll see that now these workers would have a lot more, and it would be hard for them to get the job in many cases if they didn't have that education. So it's sort of this puzzle, like what's going on? The approximate cause is, well, there's a lot more people who have the education, then employers can be a lot more picky. Right? But then, this does sort of push it back and say, yeah, but why is it they're so picky? Why don't they just go and settle for what you need rather than ratcheting up the standards? And that's where really the heart of the book comes in and says, well, one of the main reasons why employers value education isn't for the skills that it is actually poured into you, but rather just as a form of certification. They like the education because it's a way where you jump through hoops, and if you jump through a lot of hoops, then you're impressive. But if everyone's jumping through lots of hoops, then you need to jump through even more hoops to be impressive. So back when most people didn't have a high school degree is impressive. Now it's n now high school degree is no longer very impressive, and now you need to get a bachelor's degree or a master's degree in order to get employers to take you seriously. So again, it's sort of a rat race or a treadmill story where the more education people have, the more that you need. And again, this so basically there's this contrast between the normal story about why education pays, which is this skill creation theory. It just says that you go to school and skill is poured into you, and it's not entirely wrong. So people learn literacy and numeracy in school, but it's so incomplete. What about all the other stuff that you learn in school that you're never going to need to know again? Why do employers care about that? Why does it matter if you're one Aristotle class short of graduation? And this alternative signaling story explains that, and then very nicely predicts credential inflation, which is precisely what we've seen.
Indeed. So what's being signaled here is essentially conformity. That's what it's still in a lot of these more bureaucratic forms of employment. That's what employers want to see. And the college degree, I mean, the high school degree used to be sufficient. I've always said on this show that, the three hidden lessons of school are number one, obedience, number two, conformity, and number three, those first two lessons produce a kind of philosophical, political, even just general intellectual kind of apathy. Because if you obey, you don't really have to be self-directed. If you conform, you really don't have to be self-assertive. So apathy is kind of the natural result of that. So college, for many employers, seems like almost a form of certification in the ability to conform.
Right. I mean, I think that overstates it a bit. So in the book, I say there's really a trio of traits that you're signaling with your education. So you're signaling intelligence, work ethic, and conformity. The conformity is important because You know, we'll just back up. So think about this. So the most conformist person in the world, if he's extremely stupid and lazy, still wouldn't do well in school.
Sure.
So you do, right. so you do need this combination. But I do say the conformity is the thing that you're signaling that really explains why the system is so rigid, so inflexible, so unfair. Because, you know, here's the thing. If someone comes along and says, oh, I have a great new radical way of signaling conformity – well, who are the first people in line to try that idea? It's going to be the nonconformists.
Exactly.
So, right. So that's the problem, is we get this lock-in. And again, you could see this lock-in in lots of areas of life. Like, why is it that we know that people aren't going to start wearing kimonos to work?
Right.
It's like the suit. What a stupid thing to wear. But like, it's very locked in, because who wants to be the first person who goes to a job interview in a kimono, or, you know, dressed in a Star Trek uniform or something?
Right.
So, I mean, these are all things where, like, you know, once something is established as the normal thing that you're supposed to do in a society, it's pretty hard to break out of that.
Yeah.
Of course, $1 trillion of government subsidies on the side of the status quo aren't very helpful. Yeah, but like, in terms of what employers are wanting, one of the main things they're looking for is conformity. And I think there's a lot to what you're saying about how this has these unfortunate political consequences. But at the same time, like, it's very hard to understand how you would run a large business without a lot of conformity.
Yes.
You know, you can't have every employee showing up and saying, hey, I should be in charge, I'm doing to do it my way. Well, you know, like you are part of a team, and there is a reason why big corporations generally generally run most of the economy, which is that they are good at what they do. They are good at forging a bunch of individual humans into a well-oiled machine that produces a lot of stuff. You do have the option of being self-employed, but generally your pay is going to be a lot lower than if you just go and commit yourself to a well-functioning team.
Sure.
So it's functional. I mean, again, I will say that, you know, very conformist people aren't very fun to me. So
I mean,
if I just go through my mental Rolodex of friends, most of my favorite people are highly nonconformist. And yet, if I were starting a business, I wouldn't hire them.
Right.
I have tons of practical advice for people listening to your podcast who just want to live a better life, despite the fact that the school sucks.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
All right. So K-12, that's really hard on, because you have so few choices. There's so many rules. I mean, we could talk about that, but college is really easy to improve your experience. Just to start, in terms of saving money, I would just say, just go to the best public school you can get into. It's way cheaper than private school, and for most jobs, it barely matters. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there's a whole body of research on how much does the selectivity of your college matter. And the answer is, it's greatly overrated, actually. Much more important to choose a major wisely than to get into it, than to go to a really good school. So, right. And in terms of majors, there's a bunch of standard high paying ones that are a lot of work, like engineering, computer science. And then there is one standout major that is very high paying and requires actually very little work. And that's economics. Right.
Right now,
I hope I build up enough credibility for saying things that are contrary to my own interests and wishes to be believed when I say, yeah, I'm an econ professor, and the econ professor is a ridiculously good deal.
Yeah.
Right. So the amount of work that you need to do is barely higher than in other humanities and social sciences. But the pay that econ majors get is almost as good as engineers and computer scientists. It's fantastic. So you go per dollar of work, econ is a ridiculously good deal. Because you you go to college, you have your 4-year party, and you learn some economics a little bit, and then in general, on average, you get a very good job. So that's step one is, you do need to have a little bit of math, but not that much for the undergraduate. If you want to continue in grad school, which is also a very good deal, then you need more math. But undergraduate, very minimal calculus is all you need to do very well as an econ undergraduate. Again, you're not getting a lot of job skills in general unless you want to be an economics professor, but still you're getting, you're studying some interesting stuff, you're not doing much work, and you're getting good money. In terms of other things that you can do, I am just I'm not really amazed, but I feel like I should be amazed at how little effort college students make to get something out of their time there. So, the number of students who go and visit the professors and talk to them, very few. Plenty of times I go a whole semester, no student ever bothers to come over to my office, right? Most professors, they know something, right? And they have office hours. You can go and talk to them for free for hours and hours if you want to. And it doesn't even matter if you're their student, right? You can go and try to meet any professor on your campus that you think is an interesting person. So, you know, like I'm homeschooling my older sons. What I always tell them is, look, just go to the faculty list, scroll through, find anyone that you think might be interesting and spend 5 minutes to meet them. How hard is
sure.
that?
Yeah, I bet right? a lot of them would love it.
Yeah. I mean, you know, so you know, like, I think a lot of people are shy or like they don't want me to come there. And I say, look, you have any idea how bored and lonely most professors are? The fact most students are just, if they come to their office just to be there to beg for a grade, you know, for someone to come there with some sincere interest and curiosity, there's so many people who get that once a year, once every 5 years, and they'd be so grateful. And here you've met a person who has a lot of knowledge, who might be interesting, at least in their area, and who could help you in the future.
So I want to jump back to the college for all mentality that I mm-hmm. think was one of your motivations. Responding to that was a motivation for writing this book. Is that correct?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So there's actually this great internet meme that says when everyone has a BA, no one does.
Exactly.
And yeah, that's exactly there. Yeah. So when people think, well, we get all of these great college type jobs if we all had college, it's even now a lot of people with college degrees don't have what you'd think of as a college type job. So, you know, I also talk about, in addition, sort of the flip side of credential inflation is what's called malemployment, which is people who have a job, you know, they have a college degree, but they work in a Foot Locker or something like that. And that's also very common, right? So you can all, when the education levels are higher, the you know, go up, the main result is just that you're more likely to wind up at a job where it doesn't seem matched to the education or the background that you've had.
Right.
And again, if everyone had a college degree, of course, then garbage would be taken out by people with college degrees and dishes would be cleaned and washed by or would be washed by people with college degrees.
Yeah. And as I've watched what happens or what is continuing to happen in college culture, like really over the last 5 years, and I think it's really intensified over the last two or three, as far as like the emergence of these always in flux kind of social science programs that a lot of people are studying, like all you need is this 4-year degree, that this is still mm-hmm. the ticket. So, you know, the choice of major, the path towards, you know, being useful vocationally seems to be lower on people's lists of priorities, even though they're investing all this money. You know, my conspiratorial thinking about this, telling everybody they need to go to college, is it just like some mission to produce a useless society of left-wing ideologues? Because, you know, it's not so many people are going and they're spending all this money and they're going to all this debt. It's not increasing their usefulness or their, you know, employability. But one thing that certainly happened to me 18 years ago when I graduated from a 4-year program in communications, before I realized I had to go back to school, or I thought I had to go back to school, my usefulness did not increase, but my sense of entitlement went through the roof. Mm. You know, I felt really, really entitled going to job interviews, just assuming that it was like an exchange. Like, I show you this piece of paper, you show me where my desk is. You know, that was, you know, really frustrating and disappointing.
This might be a function of being at George Mason, but I would say that our students don't have any big sense of entitlement. Mm. I mean, it's more along the lines of desperately hunting to get an internship so that you can actually get some job experience. There's a lot of students who, you know, probably feel fairly low status and like, you know, again, because, you know, a lot of it is the reference group. So they're competing with people from better schools and, you know, and they have a sense of, you know, like this degree is not as desired. I mean, we're in a high wage part of the country, so that probably helps. But, I would say that, you know, students, you know, seem very apathetic most of the time. And, you know, like, you know, it's very unusual that a student comes and like acts like they know everything or that they're automatically going to be given great rewards. There's more of a sense of I could do this whole program and still not get a good job, which makes more sense as the rank of the school goes down. I would say that like for students at good schools, I mean, it's not that they have no skills. It's just that the skills were not really enhanced very much in school, right? And especially they have a lot of potential. So, again, like the way that I like to think about it is a lot of what goes on in college is that you convince employers that you're worthy of training. So,
okay.
So when you emerge, it's not like you actually know how to do anything, but they can say, all right, well, we're going to give this training to some people. And if given how well you've done in school, you seem like a good prospect. You're probably going to be able to learn what we have to teach you. So, you know, even just knowing that I'm the kind of person that employers want to train, I can kind of see that giving people some sense of satisfaction. And indeed, I'd say is in a better world where there's less education, you could get that satisfaction at a much earlier age. You could say, oh, well, high school, now I'm done with that. Now I'm ready to go and get a good job. which is the world that we used to have. And what I argue in the book is there's no reason why we couldn't still have that world, really.
Indeed. And I think what you're saying kind of relates to the what's going to be a frequent counter argument to what you say in the book, the idea of the education premium that those with a bachelor's degree earn, I think it was like almost 75% more than those who have a high school diploma. And that's up like considerably since the 1970s. But one of the arguments that we've been making every time this comes up on my show is that that's really correlative and not causative, that people who get the four-year degree just because that is a very much a societal norm. It has been for several decades now. College is a stop on a path to success that person was already on. Success, finger quotes, success, you know, I mean, at least employability, at least, you know, higher earnings, that college education is an aspect of, you know, a successful person's path, but it's not the cause of success.
Right. Well, what I say is that both extreme views are wrong. So there's the extreme view that all 75% is causal, and that's wrong. The idea that there's no causal effect also, again, when you look at the data, it's almost impossible to conclude that. So basically, my preferred story is that about a little bit more than half of the observed effect or the observed difference in earnings is causal. But again, there's a lot of ways that you, a lot of signs of this. I mean, the simplest thing is just go and try to match people up by their characteristics, like their test scores before they started, and then see how much of, if you compare apples to apples, compare two people with the same SAT score, but one finished college, one didn't, how much is the difference in earnings on average going to be? So that'll give you that result. If you just look at the extreme difference in earnings between people with 3 years of college and four.
Right.
I mean, it's very hard to understand that as not being causal. It's like, well, it really does seem like if you are just a one class short of graduation, that you are treated far worse in the labor market than if you could just go and get and complete that one class. So that seems like it's a big deal. And again, probably just as a pure signal of conformity there, where it's like, look, our society says 4 years. It didn't say 3.95 years, said 4.0 years. So if you don't do what society says, then you're going to get punished. There's also some really neat work on things like the reward to IQ depending upon your education and how long you've been working. So as you might expect, the longer you're in the labor force, the greater the reward that you get for your IQ. So basically, when you're right out of school, then you generally get a smaller benefit. Or for high school, it seems like you get no benefit at all. Employers just say you are a high school student of some sort. But very smart people with high school degrees, they do actually, their earnings rise at an unusually fast rate. But still, it takes many years for them to start getting full credit or anything close to full credit for their intelligence. What's striking is that for college graduates, it seems like you start getting a lot, most of the credit for your intelligence right after graduation. Mm-hmm. But if you either didn't finish or you didn't go to college at all, then 10 years, 20 years in order to get anything like full credit for your intelligence. So again, it seems like a lot of what's going on is that if you're smart and then you jump through all the right hoops, then the world officially acknowledges that you've got talent. But on the other hand, if you try to cut corners, then you spend a decade or more convincing people, hey, I didn't do the normal thing, but I am smart. Give me some credit for what I'm able to do. So I would say that seems to be some pretty strong evidence that what's going on is causal, but in a complex and subtle way, basically among economists, I have to go and convince them that a lot of the effect isn't causal, or again, especially among labor economists and education economists that they're so into the idea. But on the other hand, with critics of education, I usually have to spend some work saying, the extreme view is wrong, but it's also not true that there's no causal benefit. And in fact, it sure seems like there's still a pretty solid one. And I'd say, again, the main reason why education turns out to be a bad financial investment isn't that it doesn't pay well. It still pays pretty well, but that so many people don't finish. So it's more of a question of it would pay well if you finish, but a lot of people aren't going to finish. And that's the real case where you can say it's not a good investment. But if someone is on track to finish, that's where I would say I would encourage almost anyone, well, to stick with it. You're almost done, and then you get this big bag of money.